The fleet featured a unique and colorful breed of seamen known as China sailors, who might have been forgotten if not for a man named Richard McKenna.
Richard McKenna was a machinist mate on board the gunboat Asheville, and he just soaked up the atmosphere of that ship, the culture, the people that they met. He interviewed the shipmates who were in the late 30s already old China hands.
After his tour of duty in Asia in 1939 and service in World War II, McKenna returned to the United States. Although he had no formal education, he was determined to become a writer and share the sea stories that he had been told by the China sailors. McKenna completed his historical novel, The Sand Pebbles, in 1962. He based the hero, Jake Holman, a machinist mate from a small town, on himself.
He had come from a difficult background in the west of the United States, as Jake Holman had. He had found a haven, some place to go from a society that had treated him roughly. He found a home within the Navy.
The book depicted Navy life as it had seldom been seen, from the enlisted man's point of view, and from a man who had found his passion in the oil-slicked inferno of a coal-burning engine room.
The machinery became a part of him. He had that thing that he depicted with Jake Holman, that people can betray you, but machinery is honest. It gives you what you've worked for.
Originally, when McKenna first submitted it to his agent and his publishing company, it had a happy ending, and they both rejected it. And he rewrote it and rewrote it, and finally he ended it the way it does. Jake Holman dies.
Although it was unlikely that Hollywood would be interested in a book that was set in period China and ended tragically, its themes of blind obedience and racial prejudice echoed the unrest in urban America. Some critics also cited the book as an early warning about the growing U.S. intervention in Vietnam. Others found that the bestseller offered insights into the Red Scare that was China under communist rule. Before it was published, Richard McKenna managed to get his book to director Robert Wise.
The book came along with Sand Pebbles. I read it. I thought, geez, racial tolerance and all getting along, I think that was important to me. And I said, yes, I'd like to take it on and try to get a script to make the film.
A consummate artist whose career ranged from editing Citizen Kane to directing science fiction classics like The Day the Earth Stood Still and The Haunting, Wise was coming off his 1965 success, The Sound of Music, which broke box office records at the time. The director felt that The Sand Pebbles was a cautionary tale about the use of America's military power.
And I liked what it had to say, the power and the prestige and strength of the U.S. should make us not bear down on that, but to make us want to get along with all the other peoples around the world. The phrase Yankee go home just hasn't started in the post-World War II, but have been going on for a good part of this century.
To capture the life of the enlisted men who were the lifeblood of the story, Wise chose a friend, Oscar-nominated screenwriter Robert Anderson, to adapt the book. Anderson was best known for penning intimate personal portraits like Tea and Sympathy.
I was immediately taken by this book. It was a fascinating book. And I had been in the Navy during the war, and so I felt a certain affinity to it, even though I was on a battleship and this was a very small ship.
Richard McKenna and Robert Anderson met many times to talk about the exotic world of the riverboats that patrolled in a strange land and the unique group of men who had served in the Asiatic fleet.
I didn't presume to know anything about them except what McKenna told me. He was very much of a loner, and certainly Jake was very much of a loner.
Finding a location proved to be one of the most difficult problems facing the filmmakers.
At that time, we couldn't go to China. The biggest problem there was how to get the Yangtze River. So we went over to Hong Kong with our boat, and Hong Kong has no river, but there are little islands around different places. So by carefully placing my camera, I could have a little island here and a little island over here and made it look like the Yangtze River.
In addition to Hong Kong, Wise shot in the city of Taipei on the island of Taiwan. It was the only Chinese territory not controlled by communists. No Western production had ever filmed there.
The research on the film was so beautifully done by Robert Wise. He had such an understanding of the characters and of where he was going with the film and what he wanted to do with the film. It was a very firm hand.
The location required steady nerves. A week prior to filming, mainland Chinese and Taiwanese gunboats had fought in the nearby Formosa Straits. The 111-man cast and crew were given security checks and often worked alongside a swarm of military guards. Because the film was going to look at the sweep of history through the eyes of a small band of sailors on board the gunboat San Pablo, Wise knew that casting was the key to his picture.
He worked very hard to cast great types in this picture. You know, we just had a wonderful cast.
For the pivotal role of Jake Holman, Wise wanted Steve McQueen, who was well on his way to becoming the biggest box office draw in the 1960s. Hit films like The Great Escape had established McQueen's persona as a rebellious loner.
Hello, Engine. I'm Jake Holman.
If I watch him in that film, I'm constantly amazed at the little things, the little nuances in character that I've overlooked in having seen the film 100 times. I've often told young actors, watch the way he talks to that engine. Watch the way he handles those wrenches. Watch the way he handles the tools. That's what acting's about, making all those moments real. And Steve made them so real. You could smell the oil on that engine. You could see everything going on in his mind was written all over his face. His eyes told you the story.
The story depicted the clash between the military responsibilities of the Navy and the idealistic goals of the missionaries who had been serving in Asia since the 1860s.
Mr. Jameson dislikes gunboats.
Whatever flag they fly, English, French, American, they're symbols of what the great powers have done to this nation.
The director hoped to humanize the scope of that conflict by dramatizing a relationship between Jake Holman and a naive missionary new to China. He was repeatedly drawn to a screen test by an unknown actress named Candace Bergen.
What are you doing here?
Well, I keep asking myself the same question, and I'm kind of frightened. I guess I just wanted to get away. Well, it may be romantic, but I wanted to be swept up by something. And then, one night, Mr. Jameson came and showed colored slides in the basement of the church. Slides of his mission, China Light.
She just lit up the screen. And she had a wonderful, genuine freshness and youthfulness and naivete that she brought to the character that was really very endearing and worked very well with Steve's kind of gruff guy, Holman.
Other major roles were filled by Richard Attenborough as Frenchie Burgoyne, Mariette Andrion as his love interest, Mei Li, and Richard Crenna as the ship's captain, Lieutenant Collins. Perhaps the riskiest choice made by Robert Wise was for the role of Po Han, the Chinese coolie befriended by Jake Holman. Wise searched for over a month in Hong Kong and Taipei for a Chinese actor before casting a Japanese American with the single name of Mako.
You, me, can do. Jake?
Okay.
After I went onto the set, one of the assistant directors said to me, you know, he was very concerned about casting you. So I said, why? Well, I know you're not of Chinese descent.
The challenge for Mako was to overcome prejudice and suspicion by the Chinese members of the production.
It made me work harder in terms of how to become Chinese. I got wardrobes from wardrobe department, basic Chinese work clothes, and go out into a Chinese market. Haggling in Chinese made me feel more comfortable that I could blend into that environment without people raising their eyebrows, you know.
As they arrived in Taipei, the entire cast and crew entered a different world from the one they knew.
You have to remember in those days, in 1964, Taiwan, there were dirt streets, very few facilities that we would call modern, rickshaws, you know, oxen in the street. And so you just became a part of that atmosphere.
Much of Taiwan reflected the world of the 1920s that the Sand Pebbles would bring to life during the course of the production. Sand Pebbles began filming on November 22, 1965. The sheer size of the location in Taipei was overwhelming, even by Hollywood standards. The opening shot covered 2 square miles and called for 1,000 extras, 100 sampans, 14 junks, and period ships in the harbor.
That was not a visual effect. That was a set. And I think you just have to be impressed with the scope of what you were involved in at that moment. It was breathtaking.
The final element in the production was the largest prop that Hollywood had ever made up to that time, the gunboat San Pablo. Built over the course of 6 months at Vaughan and Young Shipyard in Hong Kong, the San Pablo was 150 feet long, 30 feet wide, could steam at 10 knots, and had working guns on the bow and stern. ...1926 saw the rise of a complicated power struggle in China between three main factions. The nationalists under Chiang Kai-shek, various warlords who dominated huge tracts of the countryside, and the nascent communist government that was attempting to organize the peasants.
I have authority under Chinese law to commandeer part of this place for battalion headquarters.
Let me warn you, Major Chen. If your superior officers are not prepared to go to war against the United States, they will undoubtedly disavow your actions and make amends.
Gentlemen, please. Mr. Perdellis, we're perfectly safe here with Major Chin.
The Sand Pebbles distilled the complex story into an examination of American imperialism. On the one hand, the cultural imperialism of the missionary. On the other, the interest of the military that acted as a de facto police force throughout China. This conflict had intensified since the first missionaries arrived in the 1800s.
The American military and the missionaries seemed to just butt heads constantly.
Jameson, you're to come back with me. You have 5 minutes to pack whatever you need.
Our militia of students went to fight you at the boom. I was hoping to see them come back victorious instead of you.
There was no cure for this. If the missionaries wanted to go over to the Chinese side, they would be looked upon as basically traitors. If they were to accept the help of the gunboats, as it was shown in the movie, then they're looked upon by the Chinese as just a part of the imperialistic people.
While the film dealt with foreign involvement in 1926 China, the filmmakers chose not to mention the long history of that involvement and the economic abuse that began in the middle 1800s with the Opium Wars.
The British East India Company was smuggling massive amounts of opium into China. And when the Chinese government seized the smuggled opium and burnt it, this was some 200-some thousand pounds of opium that was burned over a period of 3 weeks. The British government went to war.
A resounding British victory in 1842 led to punitive treaties that established large settlements for Great Britain, the United States, France, Italy, Germany, and Japan. The foreigners were protected by their own military and existed beyond the reach of Chinese law.
It's the treaties that allowed the West to come in and basically be a Western nation within China without any rules from the Chinese. A man could murder a Chinese and not be tried by the Chinese. That did not set well with China as it would not set well with us.
The filmmakers also chose not to portray the role the gunboats played in protecting big businesses like Standard Oil. Foreign companies exploited natural resources and traded goods with little regard for Chinese concerns. The movie concentrated on individual stories of the sailors who served in the most remote area. the river rats who called the gunboat on the Yangtze River their home.
I think the Yangtze River rats, they would probably look upon the sand pebbles and say, yes, that's the life we live. That's the way we were. Oh, yes, they were and still are very proud.
The gunboats were isolated on the river, traveling nearly 1,500 miles into the interior.
Ah, good boy, Wash.
But perhaps the most extraordinary aspect of life on the Yangtze, which the film portrayed very accurately, was the fact that Chinese citizens lived and worked on board an American warship.
Cheap labor was so massively available. They could have a long line of coolies only too willing to pick up this kind of work. So the movie is historically accurate from that point of view in depicting the situation that led to this very unique arrangement in which the sailors of an American patrol boat did nothing and all work was being done by the coolies.
Far from the strict regulations of the regular Navy, the China sailors adapted to a lifestyle that was as seductive as it was exotic and mysterious.
Hey, what you want for breakfast? Tell along, anything you want.
Eggs.
Sure, how many?
Half a dozen. You got them, over easy or what?
Yeah, over easy.
Ham?
Yeah.
Okay, one?
Okay.
We ate like kings. It was a very simple life. The Chinese stewards took great care of us.
Well, we had Chinese coolies in the fire room, which would shovel coal.
You'd go around in your cabin, and there was all your clothing laid out. The Chinese would pick it up.
They were worked on deck, used as boat hands for the motor pans, as they call them.
They'd shine your shoes for you. They did mess cooking, and we even had a couple of them that worked in the engine rooms. They were just wonderful people.
It was pretty nice living, you know. That was a really little life.
Look, Jake, we got it good here, huh? I didn't come all the way from the fleet to have it good. I'm an engineer.
Going back to the China sailors, this was not far from the era of illiteracy. There were not the training manuals, certainly not the computer programs. But in Jake Holman's relationship with Po Han, you really have an idea of how Navy people were trained in that era. It was very largely on-the-job training. Make your mistakes, learn from your mistakes.
This is the boiler. Inside belongs live steam. Debbie? Strong steam. Stim. Steam. Stim. Live stim goes through this pipe. Live stim goes into the feed pump. Live stim makes pump go boom, 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 boom. Live stim, huh?
The film, however, gave the impression that the Americans were overly dependent on the Chinese in the engine room.
As a machinist mate, that was my exact job. Steve McQueen played a good part, and I assumed that he was good buddies with the man that he was teaching. But as far as the Chinese operating any of the pumps, any of the things down there, that was a negative, that was a no.
The film accurately represented many of the experiences of the sailors aboard the Yangtze River gunboats, revealing the conflicts that were embedded in nearly a century of American imperialism.
They're despised by the missionaries, they're despised by the Chinese, and quite frankly, the American public at this time. So the China sailor has all these groups that basically despise him and look upon him as pretty much as a necessary evil.
Detail! Forward! March!
How the film handled the hatred that isolated the sailors and colored their view of a culture and its people was its most difficult challenge. The choices that were made would reflect the shadowy, elusive face of prejudice.
He had the perfect wife until...
Your wife hired me.
Master!
The Sand Pebbles attempted to tackle the explosive issues of racial prejudice and cultural stereotyping that existed between the American sailors and the Chinese at the time.
The sailors of the Yangtze Patrol, in many cases, looked down upon the Chinese, perhaps as a counter to the Chinese despising of them. You understand, you're dealing with an average farm boy or Western boy who's joined the Navy. He's never probably been out of his local community, and he's sent to China, and here are all these strangely dressed people who speak this very strange language, have strange customs, strange foods, very different value systems that he knows of, and they despise him.
Gotta train a new coolie.
What?
Yeah, one of them slope heads.
Slope head, which is, to me, a slang word, and I try not to say that. And a Chinaman would know that you said that, and he wouldn't say anything back to you.
Who's your new throttle man, Homag?
Ow.
Why don't you ask the new throttle man if you can have some coffee, Ski? Maybe he'll let you use his cup. Why, you slant-eyed bastard.
The racial stereotyping, I have no doubt that that was accurate. One of the things that does show up in the film is the use of the term slopeheads to refer to the Chinese. I was in the Navy in the Far East at the time the movie came out in the 1960s in the Vietnam War, and there was a very comparable thing then referring to the Vietnamese as gooks or dinks. And it was not entirely a hatred type thing, but certainly condescending, demeaning approach.
This was only the beginnings of the civil rights movement. There was not the same awareness today we have of racial stereotypes. The Chinese were really felt to be the hostile enemy. And the way the movie dealt with Chinese, they were either faceless hordes or the quivering coolie.
Sailor man?
I'm broke.
Or prostitutes.
Now, just look at this merchandise. Now, what am I bid for this clean, delicious piece of girl flesh here? Come on, what am I bid?
$250!
$275! Boys!
What?
Who say 300 and we see it
Ripper.
All?
Stripper!
Come on!
Stripper! Stripper! Stripper!
$350, I said $350, now that's it.
She ain't yours yet, buddy.
One of the things that's brought out in the movie slightly, but it's there, is how did the Western military people look at the women?
Hey, Homan, when you meet those pigs at the Red Cattle at Changsha, the doc over there is a man's best friend.
Right, Crosley?
They looked at him not quite as human. They were known as pigs. That was considered the normal thing. You just said pigs.
The place was full of prostitutes. And, of course, they was there for only one reason, to get a few dollars. And they would take good care of you for just a couple of dollars or even $1.
When you're cold and hungry and afraid, so am I. I'm going to stay with you all I can and take the best care of you I can. Love you till I die.
The relationship between the American men and the Chinese women really ran a gamut from the fleeting sexual encounter that was a case of momentary pleasure to the deep, lasting emotional relationship, the kind that Frenchie developed for Mei Li.
The star-crossed love story between Frenchie and Mei Li reflected the legal problem faced by a sailor who wished to marry a Chinese woman. Regulations forbade such marriages. Often the couple were viewed as outcasts by Americans as well as the Chinese.
Jake, you made it! You got it! You get a wish! What do you want?
I don't know.
Well, there must be something.
Yeah, well, I used to want an engine.
Isn't the engine still important?
Well, not like it used to be.
The film used the characters of Jake Holman and the missionary Shirley Eckert to illustrate the fact that in reality, naval officers often socialize with American or European women, but enlisted men were discouraged from such contact.
It ain't gonna work, Shirley.
Why?
Because you're going back to China Lake pretty soon, and I'm going back to the fleet.
In its crowd scenes, the film touched upon the poverty and civil unrest that was rampant in 1926 China. But the reality was even more staggering. Millions of human beings performed back-breaking jobs just for a ration of rice to survive the day.
Of course, there was massive human degradation in a society in which so many people faced problems of subsistence and lived on the margins of subsistence and poverty. You know, the picture of coolies at the rapids of the Yangtze River, in which the boats would be pulled by dozens of bareback coolies. This was a society in which human power had really come to be cheaper than animal power. It was costing less to feed a coolie than it took to feed a horse.
The film offered a brutal look at Chinese society on the brink of revolution.
Hey, look, I wonder what's the matter. They're jumping all over.
Hey, it's our coolies. They're jumping ship.
The coolies on board the San Pablo were shown as patriots who left the American gunboat in support of their own people.
Some of the current events between the U.S. and China can be directly related back to this period shown in the film. Chinese were given an inferiority complex. They're still very thin-skinned about this. They've been made to feel that they were second class, and they are now a world power.
But while the Sand Pebbles personalized the anti-American sentiment of Yankee go home, it did not attempt to capture the chaos that raged throughout the country as a whole.
Have you ever had to make a choice between...
Our government has decided for the present not to treat this fighting between Chiang Kai-shek and the other warlords as just another warlord squabble. We will treat it as an authentic civil war in which we must remain very carefully neutral.
The Sand Pebbles portrayed the general chaos in 1926 China without delving into the specifics of the uprising that became known as the Great Revolution.
The Sand Pebbles doesn't really show too well. It's what was actually going on during the time of the film portrayed. There was this large conflict going out in the countryside that the average sailor would not have understood.
The Boatman's Union has declared a strike on your ship!
Hit those boats with a hose if they get too close.
Aye, aye, sir.
The Sand Pebbles accurately captured moments of the escalating tension as the Chinese attempted to oust foreigners and unify the country under one government.
We demand that you permit us to take off the citizens of Republic of China who you are holding against their will.
You can go to hell. Hit them with a hose.
Aye, aye, sir.
We didn't want to use our guns while we used water hoses to try to soften the situation, not make it so severe for them.
The film captured the mutual mistrust between the Chinese and the foreigners. In both the movie and in reality, long simmering tension escalated into hatred.
What's he saying?
He says, watch what we do to the running dog.
The official policy of the American neutrality ended when the sympathetic character of the coolie Pohan was accused by the Chinese of being a traitor loyal to the Americans. He was tortured by an ancient form of ritualized execution known as death by a thousand slices.
1-4-5.
During the shooting, the filmmakers struggled to communicate what they needed the extras to reenact.
Chinese people who were hired on as extras didn't quite know how to pursue what they were told to do, which is to chase Pohan's character. So finally, assistant director said, if anybody catches this man, I'll give you $10. Then all of a sudden, they started chasing after me. I had to run for my life to escape their grasp. You know, I mean, I can feel them trying to get hold of me. Sometimes guys who are cutting me would get so carried away. But I'm helpless, I'm tied up, you know, and strung up on the tripod type of situation.
The movie actually falls prey to certain rather racist notions. You know, there's this scene of killing Bohan, in which he's killed in this death by a thousand slices. Now, death by a thousand slices was rarely used in imperial times, even under the old dynasty. It was only used against rare cases of sedition. And in 1905, even the imperial legal system officially outlawed any such punishment. So for 20-some years, no such thing really would ever have been used. The movie greatly exaggerated and concocted this direct confrontation between Lieutenant Collins's ship and the nationalist forces when the ship tried to sail up the Dongting Lake to get to China Mission. As a matter of historical record, there really was no real conflict.
Instead of trying to portray an immensely complicated history, the film used the fate of its central characters to capture the nature of Chinese-American relations.
Friendship. You mustn't come here anymore. You must stay on the ship.
No. Frenchie, despite the fact that he's such a kindly person and his love for the prostitute, he dies needlessly.
I told him to go back to the ship to see a doctor. But he was afraid they would lock him up.
How long has he been dead?
Last night.
Every well-intentioned American in this movie dies needlessly.
Damn all flags. It's too late in the world for flags.
Wait. Listen to me. Dong, Dong, King Mo Shuo. Wait. All right, you cover the screen.
Now, go ahead. I'll be along.
Even the movie's hero, Jake Holman, was killed. A controversial decision that angered Steve McQueen.
Steve McQueen did not like the fact that Jake Holman died. In fact, he argued with Robert Wise over it. My understanding is they shot it both ways, where Holman skedaddles back to the gunboat and where he dies at the end.
I shot the other version of the other ending of where he didn't get shot, just really to placate him, because I knew always that the right ending of the film was for him to be shot and die.
What happened?
the hell happened?
They were killed almost accidentally, meaningless deaths, almost entirely in spite of themselves.
The filmmakers took the calculated risk of a tragic ending to symbolize the future of the relationship between the United States and China.
It's the power of the movie in capturing the difficulties of the Sino-American relationship, but part of it's really the heart of the movie's misunderstanding of history. Because in suggesting that American-Chinese relations could not but have ended so tragically, it is simply grossly mistaken. And it is simply missing the real point, which is that the United States government bet on the wrong horse, so to speak. It bet on the losing side, bet on the wrong person, a military dictator who lost more and more as the years went by, increasingly lost the support of the people. And that is why he failed.
That dictator, Chiang Kai-shek, stayed in power with the support of the United States until the communists under Mao Zedong drove him from the mainland to Taipei in 1949. While the film may have ignored many particulars of military history, it remains a moving testament to the troubled past of America and China.
It's a tragic at the end that everybody gets killed. It's a sad, sad picture, but it seems to have enough vitality to it that you don't just go away. I mean, I hope you go away moved, because if you don't, I've failed and you have failed as an audience.
Principal photography on the Sand Pebbles was completed on August 10th, 1966, but it remained to be seen if movie audiences would embrace a picture that purposely defied the tradition of Hollywood's happy endings.
Attention, bargain show!
Sharing the enormous emotional impact. The Richard McKenna's prize-winning bestseller. Years in preparation and production. A continent in revolt as its locale. Thousands upon thousands in its cast. Here is the master of the art of filmmaking, Robert Wise, at his best.
The Sand Pebbles premiered on December 28, 1966. The film grossed over $27 million. And for the only time in Steve McQueen's career, he was nominated for an Oscar as the year's best actor.
Steve was born to play that role, and I still think it was Steve's best work.
My father, who is not an actor, but he said to me before I left for Taiwan, if I were an actor, I would think about your character getting nomination, you know. I thought to myself, oh, come on, what does he know?
Mako was nominated for Best Supporting Actor, one of the Sand Pebbles' 8 Academy Award nominations, including one for Best Picture. Unfortunately, the film failed to win any Oscars, but for those who had studied naval history, the nominations were recognition for a job well done.
I'm really comfortable with the Sand Pebbles' history, both the book and the movie, because Richard McKenna did his research well. He lived the life. As the saying goes, he talked the talk, he walked the walk, he knew whereof he wrote.
Tragically, Richard McKenna, the man whose work and life had inspired the film, died of a heart attack before the movie was completed. He was 51.
The sad thing is, of course, he never got to see the picture, never lived to see it. But anyway, I think we did him proud.
In the decades since its release, pride has become the watchword of nearly everyone associated with the film.
I feel honored that I was a part of it, you know, small part of it, you know. I think it transcends race, culture. It's about people.
We've seen pictures like the Sand Pebbles can be a great unifier in terms of the world. Make people around the world realize that all of us have so much more in common than we have a disharmony.
To have been associated with a film that recreates history as carefully as I think this was recreated on the screen, I don't think it's a film that will be made again. it's wonderful to be involved in something that you think in a very real way can affect the lives of young people.
Many sailors of that time will look at it and say, that's the way it was. No, I knew a Jake Holman. I knew a Frenchie Burgoyne.
I wish I still had contact with him. I've lost that, unfortunately. I had a great deal of admiration for the Chinese. They were great.
It was one of the proudest jobs of my life to be out there.
Those who patrolled the Yangtze River and the film that honored them will be forever linked. And the Sand Pebbles will continue to serve as a valuable look back into a nearly forgotten chapter in American history.